invest in this state. We need to invest in businesses. We need to invest in our kids. We need to invest in our workforce development, because otherwise you're missing that equation. What Charlie has proposed is at least $300 million of tax cuts, maybe $600 million, according to the Boston Globe. So he says, well, I'll find that money somewhere, but that's okay. He'll find that money somewhere. He also talks about all the kinds of things that he wants to do now, including workforce development. So where does that money come from? I at least am saying I know what my priorities are: investing in kids, investing in schools, investing in roads and bridges. It's why I support the indexing of the gas tax.
So if you had to raise taxes, quoting you to yourself, what would those revenues be that wouldn't increase the burden on the middle class and low-income residents?
They would be taxes on people who are at the top two or...
How do you do that? How do you do that? There's no graduated income tax in Massachusetts.
Well, we are exploring ways to do a more graduated income tax. I know this legislature's just done a study on that.
Can I just comment on this
quickly, please?
Every 4 years, someone says they're not going to raise taxes on the middle class. All right, and we've been hearing that for 7 years with one party rule on Beacon Hill. Gas tax, middle class. Sales tax, middle class. Satellite TV, middle class. Registry fees, middle class. Most of these tax increases, property taxes, fees for after-school sports, all this stuff lands on the middle class. And that's one of the reasons why I've said I'm not going to raise taxes, because I think the middle class feels strapped already. And the last thing they need is another 4 years of getting nickel and dimed again.
Very quickly on this, if I can. Martha, you oppose the repeal of the gas tax index in question one. Charlie, you support it, saying basically if legislators want to raise taxes, they should vote to do it. Well, once Beacon Hill passes a corporate tax break, and there are hundreds of millions of them, they never review whether they're doing what they were supposed to do, including creating jobs. So in the spirit of question one and your position, would you endorse a position that all corporate tax breaks should expire unless there is a vote of the legislature to extend them and renew them?
I think what we ought to do is an annual review of whether or not we're getting what we think we're supposed to get out of them. I think that's absolutely worth doing, and I would do that as governor.
Martha Coakley?
I have always said that we should be looking at whether tax breaks we give to businesses bring the money back and have clawback positions if they don't.
Fair enough. Thank you.
Let's talk a little bit about immigration. Charlie, where are you on driver's licenses for immigrants who are here legally?
I don't support driver's licenses for people who are undocumented. And the main reason for that is no one's ever been able to explain to me how you can actually document and verify someone who is undocumented. And I think there are real issues. And I get the fact that for many people this is a burden and an inconvenience. And I understand that. And I've talked to a lot of them about it. But fundamentally, we need Washington to deal with this question and to solve this immigration problem so that we at the state and local level can figure out how to deal with it. One of the things I've said I would do as governor is try to create a coalition of governors to make the case, probably in conjunction with mayors and other local officials, to Washington, that we at the local level and the people who live at the local level deal with the hard reality of our broken immigration system. The folks in Washington, for the most part, treat immigration like a football. And I think for both sides, in many cases, it works not to fix it. And that's a problem. And we need to create a coalition, bipartisan, and get after them on this one.
Where are you?
Well, I wish they treated it like a football. They're not doing anything about it. They're not even handling it. And so I know other states have reached solutions on that, Charlie. And I said I would look at it, particularly as now we have to move to a new system of real ID. There are going to be people in Massachusetts who aren't going to be able to get those because they don't have their birth certificates. There's a lot of people inconvenienced. And I think this is an appropriate time. And I've said this during this campaign. There are a lot of people who have been here for a long time. They can't get to work. They can't get to a medical emergency if they don't have licenses. I've talked to police chiefs. I don't know exactly how we do it. There's some pending legislation. But we have to address this issue for people in Massachusetts who are in our communities and make sure that we address it as a public safety issue.
Really quickly, in-state tuition for people who are here illegally, are you for it or against it?
I support the governor's executive order. I don't support going beyond that because, in my opinion, if you're going to get an in-state tuition subsidized by the taxpayer, you need to be able to work here in Massachusetts when you graduate.
Okay, so that's a no.
It's a yes for the governor's executive order. It's a no for going beyond
that. What's the governor's executive order?
The governor's executive order basically says that if you fall into certain categories where you can, in fact, work here after you graduate, then you are eligible for in-state tuition. I'm okay with that. I support that.
How about
but
you,
I'm
Martha?
Not in favor of going beyond that and basically saying people who can't work here in Massachusetts upon graduation should be able to access a taxpayer-funded education.
And how about you,
Well,
Martha?
I support what the governor has done also, but I support looking at extending that. I think that for kids who have come here through no reasoning of their own. I met a young woman just yesterday who said, you know, I want an education. I came at 4 years from Chile, and I need to have to get a job. We should be encouraging people who are law-abiding, who want to work, the opportunity to do that.
Okay, let's bring in the Boston Globe's reporter, Maria Cicchetti, please.
I cover immigration. 500,000 people in Massachusetts are not citizens. They're unable to vote, run for public office, or serve on juries. In East Boston, half the adults could not vote in the casino referendum because they weren't citizens. Is this an issue for you? And if elected governor, what would you do about it?
Charlie?
I think you need to be a citizen to vote. And it's always been that way, and that's the way I support it. And I come back to what I said at the beginning of this conversation. We need governors and local officials for whom the issues associated with the federal government's inability, unwillingness, whatever it is, to deal with the immigration issue, to form a coalition and make the case and make these guys and gals uncomfortable. I mean, it makes me nuts that every day I run into people in circumstances and situations that are compounded by the fact that the federal government has not been willing to address this question.
But Charlie, with all due respect, the Congress is not even meeting, and we're in the middle of a war. So the reality is, in the reasonable time frame, they're not going to do that. So it sort of falls back on states, governors, like you both want to be, to decide in the absence of leadership from Congress, what do you do? And so what do you do? There are 500,000 people in the state who are not citizens. Two-thirds of them are here legally, legal permanent residents. A huge number of them in East Boston, for example, as Maria said, were affected by this thing, and they don't get the vote. Your view is even on a local thing, can't do it.
Correct? Oh, I would not support that.
How about you, Martha Coker?
I think that certain cities and towns have looked at giving the local option. I think that there should be some requirements ahead of time, but I do believe, and I've seen particularly over the past year, whether you're in Framingham with a Brazilian population, you're in Chelsea, you're in Revere, we have a new Massachusetts. We have a lot of new residents who are here. They're going to be here. I know Washington isn't going to move. I'm always not afraid to sue Washington when they're not doing what they should.
So, but can you see a non-citizen who is a legal resident, legally here, can you imagine allowing them to vote in a local election? With local
I think
impact?
That's up to the local authorities, but I certainly wouldn't oppose it.
Okay, can we move on here?
Sure.
Charlie, you lost to Deval Patrick by 24 points among women last time around when you ran for governor.
Thank you so much for
reminding
me, Marjorie. I really appreciate that.
I'm going to remind you a few more
Ouch.
Things.
Yeah.
Charlie, you got in a little hot water calling a reporter sweetheart earlier in the campaign, and then you said the Hobby Lobby decision, which allowed certain corporations not to cover contraception, I think your words were, it does not matter in Massachusetts. And you did apologize for both of those. Martha Coakley's supporters made a lot of hay
yep.
about this. Do you think Martha Coakley and her supporters and the media treated you fairly about those two issues or not?
Well, I'm on the Hobby Lobby issue, I basically am guilty of wildly overthinking it. But I am pleased to say that I'm still the only candidate in the race who proposed a solution to that problem for women in Massachusetts. By proposing to increase funding, which I would do as governor, in the family health line item at the Department of Public Health to make it possible for women here in Massachusetts, if they work for a company that falls between the cracks associated with the state law and the federal law, to be able to access the contraceptives that aren't covered under that decision. And I'm proud of that recommendation, and I will always support women's access to full benefits and contraceptive services. I said when I got into this race I was going to chase 100% of the vote. And I'm pretty pleased with the response we've gotten from people across the Commonwealth, from every neighborhood, men and women, to our agenda about how we create more jobs and improve our schools and build great communities and bring balance and bipartisanship to Beacon Hill. And I've been really pleased by the response we've gotten from everybody.
Do you think Martha's supporters were unfair?
It's a campaign, Marjorie.
Okay.
I mean, I fully expect that if I say something dumb, Marjorie's... Excuse me, Martha.
Okay. People just don't call me sweetheart.
Yeah, don't worry. Martha's people are going to let me have it, okay? That's the way it works. And I would expect and anticipate kind of works the other way.
Let me ask you something, Martha Coakley. You've known Charlie Baker for a long time. Is there anything in his record or in what he's done that would lead you to believe that he treats women as second-class citizens?
I'm not, and we're not accusing him of being sexist. He's done great work. He's done a good job in the task he's taken on. I think the real issue for me, and I think for voters, is who do you see, Who do you work with? Who are you going to champion when you move forward? And look, the first response for me in the Hobby Lobby decision was, oh, no, because it's not just about contraception. It's about other forms of discrimination. And I've been very much involved in these issues because they're personal to me. They're personal to young girls and women getting equal pay, making sure they have access to health care. These aren't, academic issues that I overthink. These are things that I know are real issues for people in the Commonwealth, particularly women.
Before we move ahead, just apropos of this, Charlie, starting with you briefly and then Martha Coakley, what's the one misconception of you in this campaign when you go home at night and speak to your spouse drives you absolutely up the wall? What is it, Charlie?
That I care about numbers and I don't care about people. That's the single biggest thing that drives me up the wall.
How about you?
My entire professional career has been about people. I didn't run for the Board of Selectmen in Swampscott and stand out in the rain because I cared about the numbers. I did it because I wanted to help the people in my town. I didn't spend 8 years working in the Weldon Cellucci administration because it was about the numbers. I did it because I wanted to help people. And I took the job at Harvard Pilgrim because thousands of people were going to lose their jobs and millions of people were going to lose their health care coverage if we didn't figure out how to fix it. For me, it's always been about people, and it bothers me that a guy who is pretty facile with math, which does matter when you're talking about a $38 billion budget, is somehow considered to be somebody who doesn't care about people.
Well, so that's also what this debate is about, and that's what this race is about. And so I'll put my record up against yours. I'm not criticizing what you did. I just think it shows that when you are taking over Harvard Pilgrim, you do increase premiums, you do outsource mental health, and your salary goes up. I wouldn't make those choices, Charlie. And I have, in my lifetime as a prosecutor and as an attorney general, always made the decision to stand for people not to lose their jobs. There were 200 jobs outsourced to India at a time when Harvard Pilgrim had already been turned around. There were 700 DMH employees who lost their job and people left without mental health care because of your decisions. We can debate about whether you're a good guy or not. I don't dispute that. It's about the values that drive your choices. And I think voters are certainly...
Let's talk about the mental health issue for a minute.
Absolutely.
I'm proud of the work that we did in the 1990s, creating and building a community-based healthcare delivery system for people who no longer belonged in institutions. Those places were not great places to take care of anyone. And many folks in the advocacy community supported much of what we chose to do during that period of time. And by the way, as we sit here 20 years later, have we solved all the problems of mental health? Absolutely not. But a good piece of the work that we did and the structure we put in place and the solutions that we found for people are exactly the way the system works today.
Well, no, but let's take one piece of that. It's in the Globe today that we wanted to take people out of those institutions. But the missing piece was providing the supports and the care for them once they were out. 700 workers lost their jobs. Only 60% of that amount then went for outpatient services. And, Charlie, I'm working in the district attorney's office at the same time. I see the uptick that people are homeless, people have mental health problems, who end up in the criminal justice system because we didn't take care of them.
10 seconds. Is there a misconception about you that upsets you, Martha Coakley? Quickly.
Yeah, I think that people still think, from 2010 that I don't have a sense of humor or I'm too chilly, and I've worked for 4 years to overcome that. But
fair enough. Look, can we hear from Mark Arsenault? He's a reporter for the Boston Globe. Listen.
I've been covering casino issues here at the Globe for 3 years. If the state casino law survives a repeal challenge on the day that one of you is elected, then as many as 2 resort casinos and a slot parlor are likely to open during your first term, making you the first to govern Massachusetts as a casino state. How much casino gambling have you done personally in your life, and how does that experience, or the lack of it, inform your policies on gambling?
I have a guess, but let's start with you, Charlie Baker, and then you, Martha Coakley.
I've played a little blackjack and never done well, okay? I mean, the one time I actually made money, I sent texts to a whole bunch of my friends and said I was going to quit my day job and become a full-time professional gambler, and then I gave it all back the next day. And I have absolutely no idea how craps works, although I have watched it a lot.
How does it inform your position on casinos?
I said all along that I'm a big fan of one casino. Actually, my preferred option would have been for Massachusetts to just have the state of Connecticut send us $400 million every year not to build a casino, which I think would have been the best outcome of all. But there are a lot of people from Massachusetts who enjoy the atmosphere, the hospitality, the restaurants, and all the rest. And so I've said for a long time that I always saw